Hello and welcome back to TwoSun Tuesday, and we're taking a look at quite an old model here. This one has come and gone before I was even aware of TwoSun and starting to collect them or anything like that. This is the model TS79. We can definitely see this has just the script of NightMorning design like you would see on a lot of his older designs. Of course, back then, I do think that pretty much NightMorning and Wong may have been the only two designers that they had really signed on at that point. That they might have had some others in the wings, like Josh Watko and things like that. But I don't know. What does make this one stand out a little bit is this little carbon fiber strip here, which... Yeah, there we go. It's kind of hard to have the artificial lights actually capture that. But it does have red and silver foil accents going on there. This isn't the first knife that I have that I've had that has that material. I, of course, have the Artisan Cutlery Great White, as well as a buttonlock feldspar. That also use the exact same material. It's not exactly an expensive material, but hey, it was attractive, and this knife definitely preceded both of those by quite a few years. We have a very, very subtle understated clip there. Ends up working out all right. It is a little stiff. It wasn't actually all that bad. But still, this is definitely on the smaller side for the knives. The blade is pretty well protected in there. I can get to the very heel of the blade with my fingernail, but not my finger, so I feel safe enough with that. We got a little bit of jimping going on the back here, and it does look flush, but does feel like it sits a little bit proud, so you can actually feel that. But yeah, let's go ahead and give it a little flip here. Very, very subdued flipper tab on this guy. Very downward facing, so it doesn't stick out really, really far in the pocket. And it ends up working out quite well for rocketing that blade out there. It's got some nice jimping up here. I might have wanted a little bit more edge to it. Feels like they rounded it off a little bit after the fact. But still, ends up working out quite well. The detent on this thing really does a lot of favors to that kind of flipper design. If you had a kind of a sad detent to it, this thing really wouldn't work as well as it does. But hey, here we are. It ends up working out great. We got the plunge grind back here. So we do have a room for a couple of sharpenings there. It might have been a little bit better to have just a touch more, but still can't really complain too much on this guy here. And yeah, you're going to see that this is three and a half finger knife at best. More or less a three finger knife if I'm holding it kind of relaxed in that saber grip position there. We have a bit of a notch down here. It is essentially just a drop point, very, very subtly, but does have a little bit of a notch. I wouldn't really consider that to be a straight clip or whatever. I'd just consider it a notch getting down to it. But, of course, semantics on different blade shapes, blah, 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 whatever. Maybe that's much more important for traditional blade patterns than modern knives. I don't know. That's up for you to decide how that actually... affects you emotionally and or, I don't know, statistically, whatever you want here. What I can say, I have reprofiled this to 17 degrees behind the edge there, and didn't really bring the shoulder up all that far. This thing was crazy sharp out of the box, and there was absolutely no evidence that it was used to cut anything. It looked absolutely factory fresh. I will say, looking on the inside after the fact on this one here, that some things were done inside that I'm pretty sure weren't TwoSun factory done. But as far as the blade, it was absolutely fresh, crazy, crazy sharp. just a little under what I end up getting on my edges after I've done my my full polished sharpenings and all that sort of stuff on there. So that really, really impressed me, especially because I am not the original owner of this guy, and I'm guessing I wasn't the second either. I think this thing has gone around a little bit. But still, this thing, pretty nice as far as a titanium frame lock that's on the smaller side for you to be able to carry around a little bit in some warmer weather. Let's take a look at a little bit of the statistics there for it. 3.38 ounces on this guy here. Or 95 and a half grams. So under 100 grams, it's not too bad. You can definitely get much, much lighter, but I don't think so much as a titanium frame lock. This thing doesn't have a whole lot of weight relieving going on the inside, so you could probably knock, I don't know, maybe another 10 or 12 grams off of this thing, possibly overall. But still, this thing is pretty nice and compact. Works pretty well in shorts. I don't really have any problems with it, you know, wagging or flapping around in the breeze with my looser shorts during the warmer weather. So I don't really have any problems with that. We got some, well, I'll call them crenellations instead of jimping, but they certainly act correct that way. Nice and grippy. Not incredibly sharp, though. So, you know, just kind of right exactly where I would want them to be, so that's great. It is D2 steel, as you, well, that's definitely where they almost got their start. I think some of their very, very first ones were using 420G2, which I think is, I mean, it's a 420 steel, I think their equivalent might also be called like X38 CR3 MLV or X38 something or other. I don't know if for the DIN standards for that type of steel. Either way, glad they've kind of moved on from that stuff. And of course, they do a good job with their D2. They kind of always have. It's kind of difficult to do particularly bad with D2, but at least they do have a decent consistent source, and they have a pretty good heat treat protocol for it. So, you know, hooray, all that sort of good stuff there. Let's see, the other thing I can say is we do have an internal blade stop pin, which means it actually is driven through the blade itself rather than using anchors on either side of the liners there, or scales or frame, whatever the heck you want to end up calling that, which means that fairly easy for you to cut an even deeper choil in there if you needed to, if you really, really use the ever-living crap out of this thing for many, many years, then, you know, you could fix that up and continue rocking it. No problems there. Very teardrop as far as the handle's concerned. Kind of, to me, looks maybe like the starting point of a Rupert's drop, if you're familiar with that molten glass being dropped into water, and then, you know, it's incredibly strong until you snap the very, very little tiny fine tip at the end. This kind of looks like the thicker end of that. I don't know, just kind of a little observation I had particularly with it. We do have some nice mill lines that actually go all the way around. They don't actually connect at that last flat little area. I'm perfectly fine with that. But it does come up all the way around here. Nice and symmetrical. Absolutely love that. Would have kind of preferred having the lock bar relief on the inside there. But looks like they didn't do much in the way of actual mill work on the inside, no weight relieving or anything like that. So, you know, certainly makes sense why they would end up doing that. And then we got the pocket clip that we can see here mounted from the inside. I think this is one of the first that TwoSun have done where it's kind of hidden there. And of course, the pocket clip is not resting at all on that frame, but up on the top there. So you don't really have any troubles kind of flipping this guy out or any of that. So really appreciate that. The action on this thing is not going to ever be super crazy drop shut. No matter what I did to this thing, this is about as good as it gets. But that being said, I still don't really hate that all that much. It just maybe feels a little bit more like it's riding on washers when you're closing it. But still, rockets out super great. And we do have a little bit, it's a little subtle, but we do have a little bit of a lock bar access cutout sort of thing on that front side. They're not quite symmetric, but it's very, very subtle, but still ends up working out quite well. But a little bit of that being so easy to disengage there is probably the blade stock thickness on this guy, which is fairly thick. It's 3.85 millimeters, which, yeah, I guess that's kind of par for the course for most TwoSuns these days, but this is rather small for a compared to a lot of other TwoSuns out there. So fairly thick blade stock, but like I said, the geometry of it really comes down very, very thin behind the edge. And this thing was crazy sharp right out of the box there. Tip still nice and robust, even though with that little notch or whatever that I end up calling it, penetration works out pretty darn good on this. You're not going to make a huge hole, but you're definitely going to be able to start whatever that you want to end up cutting. I don't know, feed bag, whatever you want to actually open, sack of rice or something like that. There you go. This is very, very much under 3-inch knife, 2.91, basically from the end of the scale there out to the tip. So if you are in a jurisdiction where you can't carry a knife that's over 3 inches long, no modifications or anything required on this. It is very, very much under that 3-inch mark. It ends up equaling out basically exactly 74 millimeters there for y'all metric inclined folk. And 0.50 inch thickness here on the handle, or 12.7 millimeters. That's going to be same thickness that we have here on the Spydeco PM2. And that has a good transition over to taking a look at some blade size comparisons. So there's the PM2. Here's one of my newer additions here. This is the Para 3, which fairly similar as far as blade length and handle length ratios go. So there we go. That's pretty good. No need for the enormous Spyderco, so I will skip those. But let's take a look at some other Benchmades here. That's the Griptilian and the 940 and the Bug Out's probably a much more appropriate size for all of that sort of stuff, and of course the Civivi Elementum. That's fairly popular. Still same kind of a size range going on there. Let's clear out all these knives here. Alrighty. Yeah, I guess something that is a little bit interesting with the carbon fiber thing. It is basically just an accent. It is fairly thin, as it basically is on these. These are, of course, adhered to G10. For the Artisan and the CJRB. They didn't really need to do that here. They just milled out a little bit and then added that in there. Adhered it basically just to the titanium rather than to G10. It's a nice little accent, but no, it's not a super high-end material. I don't particularly care. And this is still fairly unique looking to me from kind of looking at most of TwoSun's other offerings, even up to this point. So, yeah, I quite appreciate a lot of that. Let's see. I think that's about all I really have for the standard review. Yeah, I did cover that it's essentially a relaxed three-finger kind of blade there. So, That's going to do it for my standard review here. We are going to take a closer look on the inside here, and I can point out a couple of things that that I think weren't factory fresh on that sort of note there. But all right, let's go ahead and do that. We still do have, even though this is fairly old, T8 hardware. In this particular case, just a couple here. First things first, opening that up, I was greeted with some gaskets here. I still actually have them laying out on my board, or at least one of them. There's the other one. So yeah, these guys, interesting. Something that OCD for EDC certainly advocates using these guys rather than any kind of a thread locker or anything like that. These were on both sides of the pivot there to kind of give that a little bit more traction so that you don't end up having your pivot screw back out. And the other thing here is the detent wrap there. This certainly doesn't look particularly factory. It functions basically like it, but pretty much any of the other TwoSuns, even some fairly old ones like the TS-16, still used a much, much smaller abrasive material just on the curvature of the ramp there. This seems like it was probably done with someone who maybe had a decently fine chainsaw file and went, yeah, I could probably do that in a few minutes and stuff like that, and knocked it out. Doesn't particularly bother me. It was, it's done rather well. It doesn't feel wonky or anything like that, but pretty sure the TwoSun themselves did not do that modification. On the inside here, we got the blade stop pin. I've, of course, lubricated that up on both sides just in case the pin actually gets close to making any contact there. Then I have that. We got their standard ceramic nylon bearing sort of things there. And there's the bearing race. Yep, and then there's the pocket clip. A little bit interesting on that one. This is a T6, unfortunately, on the inside here. And it looks like they probably first intended this to be a T8. And then maybe accidentally tapped these pocket clips to something else, or just didn't have those ones or something like that. I'm not quite sure. But either way, still works out all right. And I don't necessarily need to adjust a pocket clip all that much. I did remove those little gasket guys there because they were kind of bothering me a little bit. I'm not a particularly huge fan of them, even though some people, like I said, OCD for EDC, very much advocate for them, but I was still finding that the pivot on it was still backing out a little bit, even with these guys. So I will probably end up employing some thread locker, just because, well, it seems to be a tried and true way to end up dealing with it. But there we go. There's one other little screw that I need to take care of on this particular little guy. So let's go ahead and do that. Alrighty, so yeah, this is kind of a blast from the past. Like I said, this came and went long before I was really familiar with the company or anything like that. Of course, these were back when they were virtually only sold through auction on eBay. I think this was even before they opened and then, for the most part, ended up closing their AliExpress store. So yeah, interesting. Still a nice compact knife. Not the only one that NightMorning has done. He's done another couple of compact knives around in this these model number era. But yeah, it's a bit unique. So all right, that's everything that I wanted to cover here. So we'll go ahead and call it. Sweet, made it just under the 20-minute mark. So. Alrighty, as always, I appreciate y'all for watching, and have yourself a wonderful rest of your day, yo.